So, Yann, so we were talking about the changing kind of context and atmosphere. And my question was, wasn't that also, couldn't that be explained also by a growing maturation of African history at the time?
Yes, but at the time, the African history as a whole was changing. It was losing some of its nationalistic impulse, which had led to studies that were primarily about political history or military history, political history essentially, and a little bit economic history. So it was losing that. Marxism was actually losing ground, even though it had not been denounced yet, simply because nobody could agree on which mode of production applied to Africa or did not apply to Africa. And practical historians got lost in this maze of quotations to different authors. So it lost some ground there. And that left, at the same time, you saw the beginning of several other movements, and those had to do with an increase in maturity in African history. The first one, and the most obvious one, is one that had to do with the quality of evidence. This is the time when you begin to see real objections to the use of the interpretations made of written sources, to the uses made in general of archaeological or any other kind of sources. That is, historians who have been used to other parts of the world began to apply, to think of African history in terms of the source quality they wanted. But that's only a beginning. At the same time, in all of history, there were changes. This is the time, the late 80s, when all of history began to ask itself, what is history? Is it a narrative? Is it not a narrative? Is it a social science? Is it a humanities? And in the middle of these questions, you begin to get all sorts of special histories arising. That is, you get a development of let's say, the history of gender begins to be environmental history becomes more important. There are questions about the history of various social classes, not in terms of the Marxist questions, but in terms of how people of a particular social class look at their own history.
So identity.
Identity questions. Although it would take a full 10 years before historians and others become fully conscious of what identity is really about and what its relationship, its essential relationship to history is. I mean, you sense it in the 80s and 90s, and the questions are brought up. But the essential link between the two, that all history has to do with identity, and all identity has some form of history in it, that political ideology, in modern political ideologies, all have an historical referent, and therefore, and so on. These things will take at least 10 years to mature. But nevertheless, all of this is happening. And it means that within African history, at the same time, you have a fractioning, people become more specialized.
The literature is growing.
The field as a whole is growing. But you lose, some specialties are losing ground. One of the typical ones is economic history. Economic history becomes, on the one hand, so specialized that very few people who are not economic historians bother to follow it. And on the other hand, it is divorced, or it becomes divorced from developmental history. And the history of development is or is not followed upon the history of what acculturation was or was not in decades before. And it would turn eventually in collective identity and non-collective identity issues. But all of these things are mutating into each other pretty slowly at the time. So this is basically after Bats in the Rainforest was written, but it is of importance in another book of mine we can discuss later, Antecedents to Rwandan History. Because as it happens, questions of control of historical sources and of a very keen sense of identity and its link to history are central to the history of Rwanda.
To go on the professionalizing of African history, it seems to me that in a way it became driven again a bit more by grasping the literature, understanding the historiographical debate, and perhaps less, you know, the kind of pioneering, really foundational work that you were doing by beginning to give a solid foundation to early history and criticizing evidence and really emphasizing research.
Right. Well, you see, to a point, yes, this is true to a point, but it's also true that whereas most historians become narrower but lay solid foundations that broaden the field and establish it more firmly, nevertheless, at the same time, something is lost of an overall vision, and some problems are completely lost. It will be, you know, it is a realization that I'm fully aware of now, is that the whole problematic of what my colleague Alec Duval, who is some social scientist, what he calls occidentalization of history. That, you know, that occurs at the time and through the specializations that occur. This is the way Western history and Western disciplines in general go, by specializing and advancing further. But is it appropriate to history? Should one not keep some historians who may be less specialized and may be less knowledgeable about any and all of these fields, but keep the whole thing in mind and where we're going to? The answer is maybe yes, maybe no. In African
and
history...
And you're saying that not at the level of African history, but history in general,
yes,
as a discipline.
Yes, the level of history in general, and also African history. In African history, a typical debate about this is the debate that goes about macro history and micro history. Should we even attempt to write, let's say, histories of the colonial period in, say, West Africa or Francophone West Africa, and in a sense that it's not just a textbook for undergraduates, you know, not just something for Wikipedia, basically. Or should we not do that? Should serious historians really work on definite problems and not worry too much about the wider context? The issue is still going on. For the moment, I would say that 85% of these historians do not think that this macro history is all that important. Now, I think that from the point of view of the consumer of history, who is not an academic and who is not, you know, that it is extremely important.
Yeah.
It's only among academics that it may not be that important. So, you know, it is a real issue.
So, can I interrupt you?
Yes.
When you set up to write Bats in the Rainforest, you had this idea that you talked about, you know, what is important for African history now? Mm-hmm. What should I do? Do you think in the 1990s, when you were nearing retirement after Bats in the Rainforest, did you still have a clear consciousness about what was important for African history
yes.
at the time?
Yes. You see, what happens with Bats in the Rainforest, apart from the academic reactions or the scholarly reactions, which are very interesting in the round, is that it's somehow diffused in a very, you know, a very diffuse, diluted way into the consciousness of what Bantu actually are. in Central Africa, in the areas, well, in Gabon, in Cameroon,
And there was some institutional initiatives. Well, the one in Gabon, I forgot the name.
Well, the creation of CICIBA.
Center for Bantu Studies or something.
You know, the creation of CICIBA in Gabon does not have a direct relationship to this, but it's part of the same phenomenon, is that people began to value, that is to put a positive value on quote-unquote being Bantu. They began to put that value in Pan-African terms. So as before, let's say, a Gabonese would say, I'm an African in some context, and then, you know, I'm a Gabonese. Now a Gabonese in West Africa would say, well, you know, yes, I am an African, but I am a Bantu. And compared to non-Bantu, except for those I'm talking to in West Africa, you know, we are a serious civilization, you know.
Yeah.
That's the type of very dilute impact it had. It had a political impact which was much less favorable, and which is ancillary, I think, to the one, to the CICIBA one, is that when in the 1980s the wars broke out in the region of the Great Lakes, that those countries in Central Africa are the ones that posited themselves automatically as Bantu and were against people called Nilotes, whether they were associated with the Great Lakes area. Mm-hmm. Just as in the Great Lakes area, Bantu had become a term
a debasing term, as it
was used by the white community, in fact, in South Africa.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the role of this Bantu, non-Bantu thing in political ideologies, and it was a new role in the later 1990s, is one of the unintended consequences, certainly of CICIBA, but maybe one that, you know, that was totally unintended from Bats in the Rainforest as well.
But that's really an interesting development, but I'd like to return to the first question. So after Bats in the Rainforest, seeing, you know, the diffusion of these ideas, what did you have in mind for African history? What's the kind of path you were hoping or thinking it was really important for African historians to...
You see, after passing the rainforest, I saw a very simple task. You know, I saw that this needed to be done for other parts of Central Africa first. I also realized that if issues that dealt with classification of Bantu genetics and were solved, that it would be possible to apply this to apply this in Eastern and Southern Africa as well, that it was one way of really getting both internal history and history of a great depth. And I also saw pretty soon afterwards, not immediately, but say in the 5 years following, that in fact such histories can be considered as basically hypotheses. They are not things to believe in 100%.
They're more framework.
But they frame research questions. They frame issues for the future. And that is very useful. And that's, of course, the way our Battle in the Rainforest ended.
But, correct me if I'm wrong, but then it didn't happen. You did How Societies Are Born, but there's no really equivalent work that...
It did happen, but not exactly the same way. Schönbrunn used the same problem, went at it in a more thorough way, perhaps linguistically speaking,
and
produced both a dictionary and his first book.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Catherine de Luna is just publishing a book this year, which does not do this for a very large area, but still for a sizable area called the Botatwe language area in Zambia, and with parts outside of Zambia to the southwest, and does this in a brilliant way, because in that area there's a lot of archaeology, so she can discuss the relationship between archaeology and linguistics to a detail and into very specifics that I didn't do. So as you would expect, no two scholars do the same thing in the same way. Well, no two good scholars do. But nevertheless, I mean, this has been pursued up to a point. I think that in the future it might be more, that there might be more of this.
What about Eastern and Southern Africa? Was there any similar attempts to really try to reconstruct fairly broad early histories?
Yes and no. Essentially, you know, there are two big objections to this kind of research. The personal ones, I mean. The very first one is, where does one get the means to read all the literature, to do some additional archival research or research even in the field? Mm-hmm. You know, you need some financial backing to do this. Well, that's one. And secondly, you need some intellectual support.
Yeah.
That is, you need support not only from people in the region, but also because in almost all these cases, people have to worry a little bit about their careers.
Yeah.
How can this be worked out? How can it be received? And it's not easy at all.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I can see, for instance, how on a large scale you might do this with brilliant results for the first millennium AD in West Africa. But I cannot see where the financial means would come from. You know, I can see to a lesser extent.
Or more
there
kind
are,
of.
There are some.
You know, the new kind of models informed by hard sciences. So, you know, like this big foundation project, but that more collective one.
Right. No, you know, there are some projects that tend to work at parts of this in West Africa and that get special funding, but they tend to, again, to become too specialized.
Yeah, and, to have this kind of scope that you have both for West Equatorial Africa and West Central Africa is not happening. Finally, perhaps to conclude on this session, what about students in the 1980s, 1990s? For me, it was very clear when I arrived here in the mid-1990s that there was all this memory of, you know, the program with a lot of many students. You had really staffed a lot of positions with the early trainees here in many parts of the United States. When I arrived, of course, that had shrunk. But I'm just curious about your own experience of, you know, seeing different generations of graduate students until they retire.
Here there are some myths. There really are.
Oh, but it's a good time to break them down.
The earliest batch of students were numerous. I mean, there were times we had 24 students in the research seminars at the same time. Philip Curtin, 12, and I had 12. So that was the worst year. But essentially, so there was a large group of students. There was a very large job markets. Mm. You know, there were no persons who were specialized in African history in the US. And so between the late 1960s and 1975, these first graduate students would have a training that differed from everybody else in history and elsewhere, and a much harder training which bonded them together. They also had all these fantastic jobs to choose from. And they all got very good, most of them got very good jobs. Where the myth comes in is at the point as to how many of these remain together as one generation formed what Tom Spear has called the Wisconsin Mafia and really acted together. My own belief is that this is a very small group and not a lot. And I also believe that the notion of mafia has worked against historic graduates from Wisconsin rather than for it. Mm. But that's...
It's not something that it's now, I think, completely gone.
No.
I think it was in the 1990s I could hear that.
Right.
But not anymore.
No. Now, of course, it's been diluted again. Now, that went up to about 1974, 1975. Then suddenly, it became much more difficult to find a job. Mm. The number of students had tailed off. You see, in the earliest years, we had a large number of brilliant students simply because they had been waiting for something like this for a number of years. But since it now existed, that incentive, you know, that push was gone. And by the later 70s, we had fewer students, and the job prospects were not that brilliant. Mm-hmm. For me, this is the generation, say, of Bob Harps. Mm-hmm. So the best of these students still made prestigious jobs. After all, you know, Bob Harps got into Yale right away. Mm-hmm. But many, you know, many did take jobs that were not less prestigious. Mm-hmm. And some did not go into the job market at all. Mm. I mean, in a few cases, they simply left academics altogether. And some of them were actually very good historians. So that was that generation. That didn't last. That lasted from the late 70s until the early 80s. Then in the 80s, and in African history, we had very few students. In fact, I began to restrict the number of students that we accepted, both to try to get high-quality students, but also because I saw that I only managed to find reasonable jobs, mm-hmm, for these students to a very small amount. Now, you know, one of the quarrels at the time, and later on I had with Tom Speer as well, was any kind of a job is a job. Mm-hmm. So students had jobs if you found them, you know. But my argument had to do with horse training, actually. If you have a racing horse and you find a job for it to pull a cart, in a suburban market,
I am totally with
the racing
you
horse
that,
is going to be very unhappy.
I'm totally with you. I mean, it seems such a... It's a brutal way of saying it, but it's such a waste.
Of course.
Of, you know, resources, right. Intelligence to... Yeah.
So, intentionally, I restricted this to a smaller number of students. And, of course, once this was known, as these things become quickly now, then many more people would not apply. Mm. And at the same time, the financial help available either to foundations or locally became less and less, you know, became smaller and smaller. This was the time that we sort of began to have students piecemeal. It's the time that Michelle Wagner arrived, mm-hmm, it's the time that Nancy arrived, and it's the period at which Nancy Hunt...
That's 90s? More.
Yes, in the late 80s. Later 80s, and Paul Landau. Mm. So sometimes we had 3, 4, 5 together, sometimes there were only 2 or 3, but then we combined, most usually with political science, to keep research seminars going. So a research seminar was always going on, mm-hmm, but it was not necessarily composed of all historians anymore. So some of these students were very good, and the ones I mentioned, and some were not so brilliant, but, you know, got honorable jobs at honorable places. And since they had not been promised the world, and since I did manage to get them through a reasonable amount of time, within less than 5 years, mm-hmm, their debts were not there yet. You see, the problem of graduate student debt had not arisen by the early 90s. It was beginning. You began to worry about debts and ask students, but we still managed to get them out of here fast enough that it was not a main problem. of course, all of that has changed since.
But my impression was more when I arrived and with Tom Spear, perhaps, leadership. After you retired, the cohort was a bit bigger. It was more between 10, 12 students.
Well, when Tom Spear arrived, the first 3 years, he spent his time, I mean, amongst other things, going around the history department, finding out how you get more internal support, how you get teaching assistants, how you could get X amount of money for graduate students. And he worried less about the absolute quality of a graduate student.
I remember that. Tom Spear's metaphor was a diamond in the rough. You know, the student who are not absolutely exceptional, but become very good historians.
Right, well, diamonds in the rough and love and late bloomers have always been arguments. But, you know, it is something that you have to evaluate in relationship to what the market is, what the state of the profession is, and you know, what you think this department can achieve or not achieve. But it was, yes, when Tom arrived, you know, within 2 or 3 years, the character of the program changed.
Well, thank you very much, Jan. So that's probably it for
today. Until tomorrow.